Chapter 16. Commander von Bruning. To resume my story in narrative form. I was awakened at 10 o'clock on the 19th by Davies' voice outside, talking his unmistakable German. Looking out in my pyjamas, I saw him on the quay, talking to a man in a long Macintosh coat and a gold-laced navy cap. They saw me, and Davies said, "Hello, Carruthers. Here's Commander von Bruning from the Blitz. We're to meet him at the inn for a talk at 12, he said. His news was that the Blitz's steam cutter had come in on the morning tide. Secondly, the Cormoran, the barge we'd come across several times in the last few days, had also come in. It was clear, therefore, that the latter had watched us and was in touch with the Blitz, and that both decided to take further stock of us. Von Bruning had greeted Davies with cordial surprise. Davies had explained that we had left the Baltic and were now on our way home, taking the shelter of the islands. "Supposing he comes on board and asks to see our log," I said. "I'm not sure," said Davies. "What are we to say?" We did not know how much von Bruning knew. Perhaps he knew of Dolman's treachery, Davies' escape and our subsequent movements. We could not tell. On the other hand, exploration was known to be a pastime of Davies, and in September he had made no secret of it. It was safer to be consistent now. After breakfast, we decided to find out something about the Cormoran, which lay on the other side of the harbour, and got into conversations with two huge sailors. The twins, for such they proved to be, were most friendly giants, and asked us aboard their barge for a chat. It was easy to bring the talk naturally around to the point we wished, and we soon learned that the Cormoran was a wreckworks boat. It seemed that off the western end of the island, lying west of Norderney, there lay the bones of a French war vessel, wrecked ages ago. She carried bullion, which had never been recovered, in spite of many efforts. A salvage company was trying for it now, and had works on the adjacent sandbank. "That is Herr Grimm, the overseer," they said, pointing to the bridge above the sluice gates. "I call him Grimm because it describes him exactly." A man in a pilot jacket and peaked cap was leaning over the parapet. "What's he doing here?" I asked. They answered that he was often up and down the coast. They supposed he was bringing cargo in his barge from Williamshaven, all the company stores coming from that port. He was a local man, an ex-tugboat skipper. Davies and I discussed this information while walking out over the sands to see the channel at low water. "Do you hear anything about this in September?" I asked. "Not a word. I didn't sail in that area. I would have, probably, if I hadn't met Dolman." What in the world did it mean? How did it affect our plans? "Look at his boots as we pass him," was all Davies had to suggest. So, back to the village. We passed Herr Grimm on the bridge, a dark, clean-shaven man wearing shoes, not boots. "So," said Davies, "what about our future plans?" "Heaven knows," I said, "but I don't see how we can avoid talking to von Bruning. We must see how things go. It's past 12, and it wouldn't do to be late." "Well, I leave it to you." "All right, I'll do my best. All you've got to do is to be yourself and tell one lie, if need be, about the trick Dolman played on you." When we reached the inn, the commander gave us a hearty welcome, and I'm bound to say I liked him at once, as Davies had done. But I feared him too. for he had honest eyes, but clever ones. I had told Davies to talk and question as freely and naturally as though nothing uncommon had happened since he last saw von Bruning on the deck of the Medusa. He must ask about Dolman, the mutual friend, and, if questioned about that voyage to the Elbe, must lie like a trooper as to the danger he had been in. "Herr Dolman is away, I think," said von Bruning. "Were you thinking of looking him up again?" he added. "Yes," said Davies shortly. "Well, I'm sure he's away, but his yacht is back, I believe, and Fraulein Dolman, I suppose." "Hmm," said Davies. "She's a very fine boat, that." Our host smiled, gazing thoughtfully at Davies, who was miserable. I saw a chance and took it mercilessly. "We can call on Fraulein Dolman, at least, Davies," I said, with a meaning smile at von Bruning. "Hmm," said Davies. "Will he be back soon, do you think?" The commander had begun to light a cigar. "Probably," he said, after some puffing. "He's never away very long. But you've seen them later than I have. Didn't you sail to the Elbe together the day after I saw you last?" "Oh, part of the way," said Davies with great negligence. "I haven't seen him since. He got there first, outsailed me."
"Gave you the slip, in fact?"
"Well, of course he beat me. I was close reef. Besides,
oh, I remember.
There was a heavy blow, a very devil of a heavy blow. I thought of you that day. How did you manage?"
"Oh, it was a fair wind. It wasn't far, you see."
"Cross Gott, in that?" He pointed towards the window where Dulcibella's mast could be seen, pointing heavenwards. "She's a splendid seaboat," said Davies indignantly.
"A thousand pardons," said von Bruning, laughing.
"Don't shake my faith in her," I said. "I've got to get to England in her."
"Heaven forbid. I was only thinking that there must have been a dangerous sea around the Scharnhorn that day. A tame affair, no doubt, Herr Davies?"
"Scharnhorn," said Davies. "Oh, we didn't go that way. We cut through the sands, by the Telt."
"The Telt? In a northwest gale?"
The commander stared. It was genuine surprise. I could swear it. He had heard nothing of this before.
"Herr Dolman knew the way," said Davies doggedly. "He kindly offered to pilot me through, and I shouldn't have gone otherwise."
"He led you well, it seems," said von Bruning.
"Yes, it saved 6 miles. Not that I saved the distance. I was fool enough to run aground."
"Ah," said the other, with interest.
"It didn't matter, because I was well inside then. Those sands are difficult at high water. We come back that way, you know."
"Is that where you lost touch with Medusa?" asked von Bruning, studying Davies with a strange look.
"She wouldn't have noticed," said Davies. "The fog was thick, and she'd got some way ahead. There was no need for her to stop anyway. I got off all right. The tide was rising still. But, of course, I anchored there for the night."
The commander laughed, suddenly and heartily.
"Another liqueur," he said.
Then to me,
"Upon my word, your friend interests me. I think he had a bad time of it. In that weather? In those waters?"
"That's nothing to him," I said. "He prefers it when the going gets hard."
"I wonder he brought you here last night. It was a fair wind for England and not very far," commented von Bruning.
"There was no pilot to follow. With a charming daughter," I replied with a smile.
Davies frowned and glared at me. I was merciful and changed the subject. "Besides," I said, "we've left our anchor and chain out there."
"Well, as it's buoyed, I should advise you to pick it up as soon as you can," said von Bruning carelessly, "or someone else will."
"Oh, there's no hurry," I said. "They're honest enough about here, aren't they?" I added.
While the words were on my lips, I remembered the midnight visitor and guessed that von Bruning was leading up to a test. Grimm, if he was the visitor, would have told him of his escape. And if I had said nothing, we would be suspected. But it was not too late. And before the commander could answer, added, "By Jove, Davies, I forgot about that fellow as Vangerug. The anchor might be stolen, as he says." Davies looked blank, but von Bruning had turned to me. "We never dreamed there would be thieves among these islands," I said. "But the other night, I nearly caught a fellow in the act. He thought the yacht was empty." I described the affair in detail.
"They're excellent folk," von Bruning said, "but their fathers made their living out of wrecks on this coast, and the sight of a stranded yacht, with the owners ashore, could inflame the old passion. And depend upon it, someone has seen that anchor boy."
The word wrecks had set me tingling.
"Isn't there the wreck of a treasure ship somewhere further west?" I added.
"We heard of it today. They said a company was exploiting it."
"Quite right," said the commander. "It's one of the few things people have to talk about in these parts. She was a French frigate, the Corinne, bound from Hamburg to Havre in 1811. She carried 1.5 million in gold bars, and floundered and broke up, and there lies the treasure."
"Never been raised?"
"No. In fact, for 50 years it was never scratched at. Since then, 2 Hamburg jobs have tackled the job, and failed."
"And what's being done now?" I asked.
"Well, recently a small local company was formed. It has a depot at Memat. A few men from Norderney and Emden subscribe the capital. By the way, our friend Dolman is largely interested in it."
Out of the corner of my eye, I saw Davy's telltale face growing troubled with inward questions.
"Will they ever get those bars?" I asked.
"Ah, that's the point," said von Bruning, with a mysterious twinkle. "The wreck is totally disintegrated, and the gold has, of course, sunk the deepest. Dredging is useless, and the divers have to make excavations in the sand. Every gale washes away half their work. Only this morning I met the overseer. He was as black as thunder over the prospects."
"Well, it's a romantic speculation," I said. "They deserve a return for their money."
"I hope they'll get it," said the commander. "The fact is, I hold a few shares myself."
"Oh, I hope I haven't been asking indiscreet questions?"
"Oh, dear me, no. All the world knows what I've told you. But it gives one an interest in this abominable coast. I go and see how they're getting on sometimes when I'm down that way."
"It is an abominable coast," I agreed heartily, "though you won't get Davies to agree."
"It's a magnificent place for sailing," said Davies, looking wistfully out over the storm-speckled grey of the North Sea.
"Are there many like you in England?" asked von Bruning, with a smile of admiration.
"Like me? Of course. Lots," said Davies.
"I wish there were more in Germany," he said. "They play at yachting over here, on shore half the time, drinking and relaxing. Paid crews, clean hands, white trousers, laid up in the middle of September."
"We haven't seen many yachts about," said Davies politely.
"You speak German well," said von Bruning to me.
"I have lived in Germany," said I.
"Studying for a profession, I suppose?"
"Yes," I said, thinking ahead. "Civil service."
"May I ask, What department?
The Foreign Office, I replied.
An important department, commented von Bruning. Won't you have to return soon?
I've wired to ask for an extension to my leave, I replied. But if I have to leave David here, I shan't be missed. He'll just potter on down the islands, running aground and kedging off, and arrive about Christmas.
You're a curious pair of shipmates. What's your point of view, Herr Davis?
I like this coast, said Davis, and we want to shoot some ducks.
As to wildfowl, said our friend, there are plenty to be got, now that autumn weather has set in. But they're vile still, and want crafty hunting. You want a local man. Now, if you really wish for sport, I could help you. I could get you a trustworthy... That's very kind of Commander von Bruning, but we'd better be certain of my plans before settling down to shoot. Let's push on, and then decide. But we shan't see you again, I suppose, Commander.
Why not? I am cruising westwards, and shall probably call at Nordney. Come aboard if you're there, won't you? I should like to show you the Blitz.
Thanks very much, said Davies uneasily. Thanks very much, said I, as heartily as I could.
Our party broke up soon after this. It had been a puzzling interview, but the greatest puzzle was still to come. As we went towards the door, von Bruning took me aside.
It is about the Dolmans, he said. Your friend has an interest in the young lady, I think. I wouldn't encourage him.
Well, thanks, I said, but really,
it's only a hint. He's a splendid young fellow, but perhaps too honest and simple.
I thought the Dolmans were friends of yours, I said, looking him straight in the eye.
I know them, but... He shrugged his shoulders. I know everybody.
What's wrong with them? I said, point blank.
Softly, Herr Carruthers. Remember, I speak out of pure friendliness, or I should not have said a word. Still, I will add this. We know very little of Herr Dolman. He is half-Swede. I believe, certainly not a Prussian. Came to Nordney 3 years ago. Appears to be rich and has joined in various commercial undertakings. Sharp practice? Oh, no. He's perfectly straight in that way. But he's a queer fellow, and, well, as I say, little is known of him. That's all. Just a warning.
I saw that to press him further was useless.
Thanks.
I'll remember, I said. Outside, we joined Davies, who was knitting his brow over prospects.
What a place to be in, he said to me. We may be stuck here for days.
Too much wind to tow out with the dinghy, and too narrow a channel to sail out.
Von Bruning was ready with a new proposal. Why didn't I think of it before? He said. I'll tow you out in my launch. Be ready at 6:30. We shall have water enough then.
I indicated Davies.
He objects to towage on principle, I said. Just like him, laughed the other. That's settled then.
I asked about Essens and his business there. Essens, he says, was the principal town of the district, 4 miles inland.
I have to go there, he volunteered, about a poaching case. A Dutchman fishing inside our limits. That's my work, you know. Police duty.
Do you ever catch an Englishman? I asked.
Oh, very rarely. Your countrymen don't come so far as this, except on pleasure.
He bowed to us, smiled, and left.